more people will join us as we kind of go through, right? We are at 8:13, so let's kind of go ahead with it. So guys, welcome to this series, and let me explain to you what are we trying to do here. We are trying to bring across to you a certification program, let me put it that way, on leadership development. And who is this program targeted towards? Anybody who's an aspiring people manager, or anybody who is already in a people manager role or has just transitioned into it, or is transitioning to become a manager of manager. So there's a wide spectrum available for you here. Therefore, we call this program Leadership Transitions, which means a leader who is experiencing a certain kind of a transition in his or her career. Right? And in COVID times, perhaps a lot of us are experiencing transitions in one shape or the other. If you are, if not anything else, many of us have started managing teams which were co-located now remotely. So there is a certain kind of a volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity which is fraught in our careers at this point in time. So this program tries to help you prepare as a leader for any of this leadership journey as you kind of go ahead, right? So thank you very much. So let's start with a little bit of a polling exercise, right? So the question that I have for you, and there's a poll that is gonna get popped up in front of you in a minute or so, is according to you, what is the biggest challenge that you face when you transition into a people manager or a people leader role, right? Why I call it people manager, people leader separately is because, you know, where the organizations are today, organizations are much more flat. You may not actually have the title of a manager, but you could be managing people, right? You could be leading people. You could be leading small agile teams. You could be a scrum master. You could be a tech lead. You could be a voice lead. You could be a voice coach. You could be an HR business partner. You could be an HR spork, right? So, and in various shapes and forms, your performance is actually dependent upon the performance of a group of people who directly or indirectly report to you. Sometimes they could be just vendors to you, as tenuous the relationship as it can be, right? It's not always a very solid line that connects you to people. Gone are those days, okay? So what is the biggest challenge that you face when you are trying to manage people, when you're trying to lead people? So let me, I've got a few reasons. You can put, you know, your top three, you can click on the top three for yourself. I've got 10 odd reasons. And if you think that I've not covered something that is in your mind as one of the top three, feel free to chat about it, right? Feel free to, put it on the chat window. We will try and take it on, okay? So here goes the poll. Can you see the poll, guys? You can start clicking on it.
Not okay. Yet. Yeah, just no come. Okay.
Yeah, give it a moment for it to kind of come through. Okay. Okay. Just imagine trying to do an exercise like this in a face-to-face classroom, right? You would have to sit and count and do something like that, right? And here's real-time analytics playing out in front of you, right? Almost bar graphs getting populated in the wink of an eye. Okay. So Priya, what is the trend that we are kind of trying to get here? Which is the top one, right? So 14 of 19.
Okay. The maximum of them managing conflict.
Mm. That's up your alley, right?
Yeah. And then goes managing change, building trust and accountability, and then the creating positive team environment. Yeah, right now with this remote environment, I know, positioning yourself as a leader.
Alok, can you see interestingly what is happening here?
Absolutely, Ravi.
Right. Yeah. Look at.
Is there a graph which is presented?
It'll come through to you. I'm just waiting for all the 20 of 20, at least 18 of 20 to respond.
Yeah.
Have you responded? Done?
Yeah, I have responded. Yeah.
Right. Have you responded? Okay, great. So I'm ending the polling and I'm going to be populating the results, right? You can now see the results, right? And here is the result, okay? Can you see the results now?
Yeah. Right? Managing conflict it is.
Now, for me, it's not what is the top. Of course, that is a concern and we will talk about the current times and probably what is contributing to that mindset. But if you look at it, managers 10 years ago were worried more about managing performance of team members, right? Some of you who are, Praveen, you would probably remember, right? BQ management, bottom quartile management, people who are, you know, performance management,
yep,
performance improvement plans, PIPs, right. PAPs, right?
Lot of things.
So that is not a concern today.
Yes.
That is not a concern today, right? So what is a concern, right? Positioning yourself as a leader, managing conflict, 50%. That's a staggering number, so good. So I think this is a very important piece of data that we have, right? Priya, if you can just take a small screenshot of this and if we can, you know, keep on referencing this. What I will also try and do is, just give me a moment.
Sure, take it.
Right,
okay. Yeah.
Okay, superb. So as we kind of look into this result, right, here are some of the things that I want to share with you this study, right? Often leadership transitions are kind of predicated by, or are kind of, you know, people get into this myth versus reality tossing up or fight, right? This jostling, this tug of war, right? So just look at this study that I have in front of you. This is from Harvard Business Reviews. It's a landmark study. I mean, you know, 2007, but then it has kind of continued to have resonance with organizations for good amount of time. So does this still cut ice with you? Have you seen yourself experiencing any of these myths? Have you seen your managers experiencing any of these myths?
Absolutely.
Any particular one that you want to talk about?
I think, Ravi, I'll take my example. There's Alok here.
Right.
The source of power, now that is very relative from LOBs to LOB. I'm talking about Dell.
Right, lines of businesses, yeah.
Lines of businesses. I will finally be on top of the ladder. That, you know, we used to have the OHRPs and all those meetings of, somewhere the mid-management were always confused in what's next, because after an average performance, when you are a valued performance in that mid bracket, there is nothing else what you can build on. So that source of power, everything, but folks, we are wary and you really have to earn it. You know, that was that was not very black and white. There was a lot of gray matter, not gray matter as in brain cells, but a lot of gray area, which was unexplored. And we used to have a lot of discussions ahead, breaking our heads and all. But leaders would not provide or may not be able to provide us guidance towards that. And if you see, most of them were growing to a certain level. I'm talking about developing as a leader and then not move forward.
Right.
So somewhere that source of power. So, you know, I just wanted to say that. Yeah. That was one of them.
Yeah, the other thing that has happened is, and that's a very important thing that you're talking about, careers plateauing, right? I mean, you kind of reach a glass ceiling and you don't grow beyond that. Now, to your point, what you experienced maybe, I would say 3 to 4 years ago, is becoming much more endemic now. If organizations had 8 or 9 layers, now they would pretty much have 4 to 5 layers.
Yes, right? Yes.
Startups have 3 layers. So you have a CEO, you have a manager, and then everybody else is a co-worker. Right? Yeah. So if you're working for a startup, you basically have 3 to 4 layers, not more than that, right? At best a lead. So, you know, authority based upon layer as how many span, you know, how many, 200 people I manage.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I manage 20 managers and they manage. So, you know, this pyramid structure is falling apart, right?
Yeah.
So you are now kind of having to earn the respect of people. And earning the respect of people is by your behavior, is by your resonance, is by your human faculty.
Correct.
Because the people who are coming to work for you at many a times know their stuff as well as you do. In fact, the younger ones probably know even better than you do. I have seen leaders you know, who did Core Java jostling with people who have done AngularJS now. Right. So, you know, they used to take 2 pages to write that code. These guys kind of write it in 2 lines. So, you know, people from the software industry would probably agree with me.
Yeah.
Irrespective of whichever industry you have, the millennial population is not going to respect you just for information. It's going to respect you if you are typically getting their commitment, you're leading the team, right? And then stuff like that. Anything else that resonates? Anybody else? Just spend another couple of minutes on this slide before we kind of move forward.
Ravi, I wanted to add something. The last one, I am responsible for initiating changes to enhance the group's performance. So it was a myth that, you know, the team leader or the people manager is only responsible for thinking and brainstorming and breaking his head to identify areas of improvement and, you know, initiate changes and drive people to achieve their goals. People have become much more career oriented these days. They're much more focused and they're very clear about what they want in their careers or in their performances. In fact, I have seen people approaching the managers, I mean, the senior management and saying, this is what I want in my career path. What do you have in plan for me?
Absolutely.
So I feel that is one huge change that we have seen in the recent years.
Yes, Vidisha, that is so important. And we are going to talk about this when we talk about the module called Leader as a Coach, right? Okay, super. I think that's a very valid one. People are impatient about their career, right? They are not going to be with you forever, right? So, you know, year-long career plans, IDPs are becoming passé now. They are working with you for a sprint for 3 months. Here's a guy who works for Infosys. He comes and works with Dell for a project for 2 months, then goes back. So he wants to sponge in the entire learning that he can have during this period, right? So as a leader, you are on from day one, right? And he needs to see the best in you. So that's one important thing that you have to kind of look at. So as you can see, the focus is changing more from what we used to call a very hard leadership, right? Which was based on formal authority, on control, on managing one-on-one, right? On discipline, to much more cooperation, commitment, collaboration, interdependency, getting people to give their best, motivating people or creating that, you know, environment of empowerment and stuff like that. Now, so that is exactly what has brought us to create this program and present it in front of you. right? So this is the preview for this program. So what we have for you, if you typically look at it, here's the program that we are presenting to you. It's a certification program. If you complete all the parts of the program pretty diligently, we assure you that you will get a certification towards the end. You know, you have all kinds of certification today, Scrum Master, PMP, Prince 2, all kinds. But if you have to do all of that, you seriously need a strong people management background, a strong background of people skills. And we see that there is, in an open area, we have been running this program for corporates in various shapes and forms, right? But in an open forum, there is a paucity of a program like this. So what we created is a blended journey for you, which would comprise of live sessions, which would comprise of one-on-one mentoring, which would comprise of learning from peers in a cohort. Cohort is a learning group, right? And learning through various strategies. So typically we would have one live session every week, weekend rather. We propose to have it on a Saturday, which would be 120 minutes through a medium like this, highly interactive, getting all of your views, lots of practice and practical exercises, what we call as case in point discussions, where you bring in your situations, we try to solve them through the concepts that we are learning. Then there is this, we know that in a classroom setup, many a times we are not able to talk about our personal issues. What is it that is blocking our career? What is it that is stopping us from being the leader that we want to be? So for that, we have this one-on-one mentoring and coaching bit, right? So we have honestly, Arif is pretty well endowed with this. We would have Shija as well joining in. Shija is now based out of Switzerland and she is still with Arif. She does a lot of work on coaching for senior leadership. So we would like to bring to you that. So you have an opportunity to fix a time for half an hour during the week with a mentor or a coach and share your experience and move on, right? And this will be a lot about why are you not able to make the change or what is it that's your mind block that is stopping you, right? So your mindset issues. So we will be able to surface that. And this is real-time learning, okay? Then if you look at the cohort-based learning, typically it would be a lot of application exercises, sharing of videos. We are going to use WhatsApp, very simple, right? So lots of small caselets on which we would like you to comment. Maybe shoot a video of yourself having a conversation, take opinion from other team members. And one more important thing that we are trying to do for you as a part of this program is to bring in some industry experts. Right? So we have expertise, but we would also like to hear from some of the industry leaders as to what do they expect the young leaders to be like, right? And that gives you an opportunity to network with these leaders as well, right? And also learning partner, it's like a buddy. So Bidisha, if you join the program, and maybe Krishna, you become buddies. So you kind of share each other's learning and do a report out. So There is a mix of methods. This is what we call as a blended learning approach, right? Which kind of tries to bring to you, apart from the 120 minutes of classroom session, a lot more learning throughout the week. Now, how much time does it mean? I'm not expecting you to give me more than 1 hour apart from this 120 minutes, right? So it will happen at speed, at your time, pretty flexible, but pretty rigorous at the end of the day. Bite-sized learning along with intensity. That is the uniqueness of this program. So Priya, would you like to talk about how typically a day, how typically a week would pan out for somebody who joins the program?
Definitely. So the first thing would be you sign up and then, spend or invest, I would say, that 2 hours wherein we'll take each topic every week, depending on the responses that we have got and also the other topics. Mm-hmm. post discussion, we will have some activities, some homework per se with us. So, you know, post Saturday, Sunday, you sit through, go through all that we have, learned, discussed, do the, activities or whatever the task has been given. Figure out a time, with the mentor in that particular week to discuss, and then the next week, pretty much that.
Right. And maybe a little more exchange between, which is asynchronous, right? In the WhatsApp group, right? So it is going to be fun learning. It is going to be not only learning from us, but learning from the peer group, right? And you will see that as we kind of unveil the topics to you. We would like to bring you some world-class research, some world-class work, not just academic work, but also work which is practical for you, which helps you to crack an interview if you want. I mean, I'm being very, very, very open about it, right? An IJP or an interview for a manager. Because honestly, organizations today want talent to be ready-made. It's like a pre-mixed talent that they're looking for, right? And some of the HR folks who are on this call will probably, resonate with me as to what I'm saying, right? So typically in a manager interview, they'd ask you, how many people have you managed? What's your biggest concern and stuff like that. So this program kind of helps you to make that transition beautifully. Okay, I'm going to come back to this slide in a little while. Let me take you through what do we have for you week on week, right? The key themes for the learning modules. Okay, any questions that you have at this point in time before I move ahead? Anybody? Feel free to come off mute and talk. Praveen, Tamal, Shripriya, Satya. Hi, Francis. Thank you for joining in.
Welcome. Thank you so much.
Hi, Ravi. No questions.
No questions?
No questions about the course that you guys are getting. Apart from the course in this preview, I met some little off board. But does your course include how do we handle the individual goals versus organizational goals, aligning individual objectives and goals to the organizational goals. And stepping up as a leader, stepping up as a coach, motivating them, inspiring them. Can I be brutally honest here?
Absolutely. Please.
These are so sounding fantastic in a conference webinar. These are maybe when you interact with them live, but what I have observed is 7 years of leadership is that people get inspired when actually they want to be inspired, not when you want to inspire them.
Right, you're right.
And conditions apply. And
right.
In a leadership role, like a people manager, I was called a rockstar people manager in my previous stint before I started to transform. And people, we plan their careers and say, "Choto, kam aisa nahi hoga, kam aisa hoga. Dekho pehle seekho, baad mein karo." And we plan their careers up, and as you rightly pointed out, they are so impatient in developing their careers that they want to move on. And now the question is, what is the definition of growth in their dictionary versus your dictionary?
Sure.
What is career advancement in their dictionary versus your dictionary?
Yes.
And we, as people, leaders and managers, we develop this program, individual programs and group programs, so well thought. But when you're trying to implement them, people would technically do not have time in the 10 hours daily to focus on their self-branding or building their own careers. Mm-hmm. Versus, you would not have enough time to motivate them, inspire them.
Right.
Without any selflessness, because you have your own goals and objectives chasing. For example, take I can connect myself to the outsourcing industry leaders in the conference now. Your client is paying you per hour dollars, per month retainer fee.
Right.
And I cannot be teaching my guys 2 hours a day.
Right.
So how do we handle this? Yes. Is my specific question.
Yes. I think it's a very, very important question. Thank you for putting that across, Satya. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's a very Satya question. Right. It's the truth. Right. So that's exactly what we are trying to do. If you look at, you know, we have been trying to look at people development seriously as another subject apart from the day-to-day work we do. Now that is a mind shift that we are trying to create through this program. Learning is a part of the work life. It is not apart from the work life. It will happen as you do your day job. It will not happen after you do your day job. That requires a certain shift in mindset. That requires managers to be equipped with a new set of skills, or what we call a skill set, and a new set of tools to work with their people. This is exactly what we are trying to do in this program. So if you look at it, how do you do this? This is exactly the case in point discussions that we are trying to bring in. But you cannot simply do the case in point discussion unless you understand what is the background that's working on. We are not going to be teaching you Maslow during our session on motivation. We are going to teach you how do you create a bonding in people so that people see their future in you and in their organization. How do you create trust without seeking so-called loyalty? You know, loyalty and trust have often been confused to be the one and the same, right? So we will be kind of jostling with some of these key aspects as we kind of move forward. Radhesham, if I could request you to put yourself on
mute.
Can we?
I'm just putting
right. Okay. Superb. So let's take a look at what do we have for you. Let's give you a quick sneak peek, right? So the first thing that we have, like Satya, what you said, is establishing yourself as a leader. Because as you said, the individual contributor, you are superb. You have your individual goals still as a leader. Many of us are what we nowadays call as player coaches. So you have an individual goal if you are in the banking sector or in the IT sector, and then you have a people leader role. So how do you kind of marry in both? How do you optimize productivity as a leader as well as probably on your individual goals? And how do you create alignment to the larger vision of the organization? So what changes in your life when you become a people leader? What becomes deep work? What becomes shallow work? We kind of redefine productivity here. And we help you to do this through some latest research in neuroscience and systems thinking, right? These may sound a little jargon to you at this point in time, but believe me, they are very practical tools. Once you start working with them, you will see that you can become at least 2x productive than what you are right now. For example, as a people leader, your productivity comes from building relationships. As an individual contributor, your productivity comes from fulfilling your personal goals. Now, how do you create a balance between these two? This is what systems thinking and deep work and shallow work is going to do that for you, right? And how do you kind of position your brand as a leader? Because, you know, you have become a people manager till the other day. You were one amongst these many. Now you have to kind of break off and create a brand for yourself. How do you do that positioning? How do you earn that respect, right? So that's the work, the talk as a leader. The second week is going to be about managing self, right? I mean, I'm sure you have had leaders who blow their top very easily, who have not been able to control their emotions, and the other ones who have been able to control emotions, have been able to give you the best advice, have recognized the emotions in you, stood beside you at your time of trial, right? So how do you become that resonant leader who can demonstrate emotional intelligence at the workplace? Because emotional intelligence is something which grows throughout life, unlike IQ, which you are pretty much born with and you develop till the age of 11 or 12. Beyond that, you don't. emotional intelligence is something that you kind of keep on growing. And honestly speaking, this is a oft talked about topic, but to go through a rigorous program or a, you know, a week-long exercise on this is not something that we normally do, right? So this is something that we will take a very deep and hard look at, okay? So moving on, we have the next piece, which is on motivation and empowerment. You know, what motivated people in our parents' generation and what motivates us versus what motivates the millennials who are working for us, some of you are millennials here as well, is very different, right? Organizations can pay very little premium on rewards and recognition anymore, especially in the post-COVID world when we all are taking some kind of a hit on our salary or are being told that you are not going to get a hike in days to come. How do you create this environment where people see their tomorrow in your organization, in your team? And you can do that when people feel that they are getting more competent, they have somebody to relate to, and they are given a sense of choice. The most important thing is you might have to do this in a remote environment. You don't even have the luxury of meeting the team members every day. You are not even able to observe their body language. So how do you really create a motivated environment based on empathy, based on emotional connect with your people? So that's something that we are going to work. And these are all workshop mode programs, guys. We are not going to do the teach stuff. We are going to throw some concepts at you. We are going to throw some cases at you. And then we are going to look at cases to come from you, which is what we call as the case in point methodology. And then work through these cases as a group through the week. That's the objective of this program. That's how learning will happen. Real-time learning on concepts. But, you know, concepts are necessary. You just can't do it with so-called common sense. But also with, you know, relative practical application to what we really need to do, right? Priya, you want to add anything on the motivation piece?
I think pretty much you've covered it. Motivation, I think we will touch base on a lot of real-time challenges that we have in remote working, wherein we sometimes ourselves do motivated. How do we keep ourselves motivated and then team, keep our team motivated? You know, what amount of trust is required to have, I think pretty much all these, what you have covered.
The next piece for us is, this is a very important piece, and I'm just going back to that conflict and what the question that Satya asked. Many of us think that we have the silver bullet for people. We will give them the recipe for success. This is what we call as ladders of inference. What got you here may not get you there or may not get your team there, right? So come out of the delusion of success and look at success from the eyes of your team members, right? So we are going to be talking to you through this methodology that we at Arev have kind of filed our own trademarking patents for, this methodology of this three-step model of recognize, respect, and reframe. Entire way of learning with your people, not at your people, but with your people, right? So that you are able to create more high-performing team members. Your methodology works with one or two, and they go on to become your go-to people, but the others feel left out. Now, how do you create a team environment where everybody is in it together? It is not just gender-based hiring that is going to make the day for you. It's not just going to be talk about diversity and inclusion that's going to make the day for you. It is about really appealing to the mindsets of people and resonating with them, right? So a lot of empathy, a lot of work on resonance, a lot of work on practical, difficult conversations. That leads us to the fifth module, which is about the most important piece, you know, different strokes for different folks. Some people are capable, but they are not committed. Some people are committed, motivated, but they are not capable. You know, the skill will matrix, as we keep on calling that, right? So how do you give feedback which works for each one of them? How do you bring in that situational or contextual leadership to create that right level of empowerment? You know, how do you balance this directive versus supportive feedback? When do you put your arm around a guy and, you know, help him to feel confident when he's lacking something? And when at the other time you kind of pull up the socks and give him a target, which is a stretch target to work on. So we are going to find, how do you find that good balance there? This will help you create an environment of trust. As I told you, trust is no more based on loyalty, right? In this post-COVID world, the word loyalty is not going to be there in this VUCA world. You're uncertain. You're ambiguous, right? So how do you create trust? Your trust is based on interpersonal relationship. And this is how we are looking at this, okay? All right. So the sixth module is going to be for a leader as a coach. Now, coaching is a very important skill for a leader. But often leaders have looked at coaching as being SMEs. I know, my people don't know. Now, that's not the case anymore. You might actually have people who come and work in your team who are subject matter experts in their own rights. Or these millennials who have passed out of colleges, they feel that they know. They come with a halo behind their back. Now, you can't put them down. So how do you become an enabler rather than becoming that barrier where you kind of, you know, wallow in your own autobiography and say, "Hamare zamane mein aise hota tha." Now that's not going to work, right? So how is it going to work is by creating a learning focus, coaching for empowerment, asking questions rather than just giving advices. So the example that comes to my mind is like Gary Kirsten and Sachin Tendulkar. You know, when Gary was coaching Sachin, I think Sachin had better career stats than Gary had. But still, Gary was the coach. So what did he create? He created more reflection. He allowed Sachin to be himself. Now, how do you do that as a leader in an organization? Can you do that to all people? Can you do that to some people? To which people do you want to be that coach? So these are some of those, you know, very intriguing conversations that we are going to be part of in this program, right? Priya, you want to add something on the changing focus of coaching? You have been doing a lot of mid-career stuff.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, we can also look at, you know, third point of view. You know, sometimes we, you know, I as a person or I as a people manager, tend to think that I, you know, because I'm a people manager, I have to coach my subordinate or, you know, my people. But sometimes it is not required. So does a manager need to coach his or her people all the time? Is it required? So a lot of things, you know, in terms of those, we will discover and understand about individual as a people manager. And yeah, sometimes the leader needs to be coached, not the subordinate. Right. So we will touch upon those things. And how can you be, you know, effective manager, asking right kind of questions, because asking right kind of questions are very, very important.
Right.
Yeah. All these
Yeah. The questions carry a lot of meaning, right? Hmm. And the tonality carries a lot of meaning.
Yes.
So you did that? How did that happen?
Yeah.
They're two different questions, right? Okay. Yeah. So we will look at some of these. It's not just as simple as changing the tone. Okay. Now, managing conflict, right? Conflict is part of our life, Priya. Go ahead.
So yeah, I think conflict is something we all deal with, and it's part and parcel of our personal life and professional life. However, we will try and work through how we can convert this conflict to collaboration, have a win-win between teams, and in this agile environment, in this remote environment, how we can, you know, deal with it, how we can figure out, how do we understand the other person, you know, put ourselves in the other person's shoes before we decide or comment or take action or perceive people, be not being biased, understand what kind of person we are before and what kind of approach do we have in terms of understanding the other person or taking decision. So we will dig deeper into our own personality here and how do we make our decisions on the basis of a scenario and work upon those things.
Right.
I think we'll dig more deep into the different various types of approaches right. that we have.
Right. Yeah, the approach is going to be to find how do you create a third alternative. Mm-hmm. And you can only create a third alternative when you're not hung up on your own position. Right. Mm-hmm. So how do you become a little more humble, if you may like, right? Influence without authority, positional authority. How do you listen without preconditions? How do you stay non-judgmental, right? How do you not make every conflict an identity-based me versus you kind of an interpersonal tug of war, right? How do you kind of look at it a little more strategically, a view from the balcony, as we would call it.
Look at us, you know, instead of me and you, look at us.
Look at us, yes. So we are going to be working through some of those strategies, and just a sneak peek for you. The eighth one is probably the biggest need of the hour, the biggest ask that organizations are having from managers in post-COVID times, right? Which is leading change. I mean, look at it. Some of us who are from Dell will tell you one slogan that we were given right on the day one of induction, no 2 days at Dell are the same, right? And probably that applies to most organizations today, right? So understand how do you create that need for change? How do you are able to overcome some of those roadblocks that people may have, the mindset issues people may have? How do you create a plan and an execution or plan an execution for change? Sometimes you just get a change mandate from the top and you're like the tomato in the sandwich. So you get squished, your people are pushing you up, your top management is pushing you down. How do you still retain your composure, your emotional balance, and still drive a change in the organization, right? So we will be looking at both the people side of the change and the process side of the change together to see how we can have a seamless change execution approach coming through, right? So these are the 8 modules that we thought are the need of the hour. This is typically not the run of the mill as you would have thought a leadership program, right? So any questions that you have at this point in time, once more, 8 weeks, you know, it's an 8x3 model. Tell me, what do you think? And yeah, I see a couple of chats popping up, right? Hi, Sachidananda, hi. Any questions that from anybody, feel free to come up. I am going to share with all of you an article from Linda Hill, the one that I was referencing right at the beginning, right? You can take a look at that, right? And feel free to, you know. Take a look at that. Okay. Any questions that you have at this point in time? Does this journey look too much for you? Too little for you? Too difficult for you? Satya, any responses from your side?
No, it looks promising. So 8 weeks and 3 module training looks certainly promising, and you've got most of the Bay Areas of the leaders or aspiring leaders, or I would rightly put it as the leadership practitioners. Yes. You cannot call yourself a leader. Right? It is just that you practice leadership, and you cannot call yourself as the best of it. Mm. It is always learned. One input, maybe you call it so, that I want to add is, it is so imperative that we focus on unlearning, as you said.
Yes.
What got you here won't get you there. Mm. People should be willing to unlearn what they had learned and again get onto the ladder and then start running again.
Right.
So that is for me. I don't have any suggestions or anything, but I have a request. Since we have spent about an hour now in this meeting, do you have any hack tip that you want your audience to take away? That's a great brief of your course. I totally understand, and I know it is worth jumping on the course and for the 1 hour that we have spent here, apart from the preview, which is the main length. Do you have any hack that I can just quickly jump out of my cabin and call in my 2-3 leads and share that, hey, you know what, I spoke to Ravi Priya and
that. Yeah, I will send that to you. I will send that to you, and we will reach out to all of you, and that's what we want you to do. But we want you to understand first before you can recommend us, right? Mm-hmm. Like Francis, thank you, Francis. You find the roadmap to be defined. If you can come off mute, if you have any observations before I, you know.
Yeah, sure. Actually, I've gone through the entire roadmap, and it sounds very interesting. Also, every topic is well defined and it's very clear. So I feel so it's going to really work.
Right. So I think, you know, a lot of it will depend upon how much of earnestness we bring in, because it's a journey, right? And journey requires commitment, right? I mean, if you decide to get off the train, it becomes very difficult for us to, you know, get you back on the train, right? Okay. So now if you typically look at it, what I have for you, and I'm going to put this, up for you on the chat window. I have this small question for you before I unravel for you the course, you know, the cost, etc., and stuff like that, right? So let me put it on the chat window. If you can click on this Mentee link, right? Mentimeter is a fantastic tool, and you'll be seeing us using a lot of these kind of tools during the workshop, right? And this is live collaboration. Just click on this link, and if it asks you to put on the participant code, do that, right? And you will be seeing some answers populating for yourself. Are you able to do that? Yes, no, guys.
Is everybody able to see the pop-up with the question, how do you feel about leadership transition?
Yes.
Yeah. So you can put three words there. Right, you can put three words and see how it goes. Right.
Yeah. Done.
Right. Okay. All right. You can see it coming through now. Right. So six people have attempted. A few more. Right. By the way, these are some of the tools that you can use for managing your own virtual teams, right? For collaborating. This is a fantastic tool of creating presentations on the go, right? As you can see, as you put on words, it starts reorganizing itself. Okay. We have 11 of you, we have 23 of you here. So 20, I'm looking at least 20 odd responses. Okay, I see one chat.
Ramneet is done.
Okay, once you're done, you can quickly keep on saying done on the chat window as well.
Yeah, done long back.
Right. Okay, so
Alok is done, Amir is done.
Right. So we can see words like trust, learning, intervention, accountability, journey, helpful, clarity, detailed, evolve, right? Yes, effective. Workshop mode is good. Okay. Okay. So, you know, the words which are bigger are the words that most people have repeated, right? So,
Learning.
Yeah. Trust. Very important pieces for us.
Yeah.
Right. There are 14 of you, as you can see. Can you see my screen, guys?
We have another 9 people to finish.
Yes, Ravi, we can see.
Right. There are 9 people to finish. If you okay, lovely growth, need for growth. Okay, Shripriya, you are done. Thank you, Shripriya. And you know what? This is a free tool. You don't. This is not the paid version I'm using. So if the free tool gives you this much, you know. So imagine trying to do this in a classroom. Alok, how would we do it? Post-its?
Yeah. This is amazing. This is just like the millennial tool. Amazing.
Millennial tool, no?
Amazing.
And the best part about it is anonymous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See? Satya, you were talking about, right? I was telling you, trust minus loyalty. Right? And that happens when I have a voice in the room where I'm not going to be penalized.
I work on a program called Trust 360 for about,
right.
We took about 24 months to build that.
Right.
Trust 360 was the line, and it was hell of an experience.
Absolutely.
And it had about 580 participants in the organization.
Okay.
It was about the center of excellence, people.
Okay.
Okay. Great. That would relate to most of the phrases
that
you use.
Yeah. So I think that's what I'm trying to put across to you. That honestly, are we reinventing the wheel? We are not. But we are putting a context to the wheel for sure. Right? That is the effort for us. We are kind of trying to situate this program in the post-COVID times. Do it in a means or do it through a method, right? The medium is the message more than anything else. And if the medium is agile, if the medium is through methods like this where we can collaborate together, all voices are heard, we can do role plays, we can do stuff like this, learning will become more accessible and managerial capability will have to be honed accordingly, right? Great. So let me kind of come back to my slides for you, right? So thank you so much for sharing this on the Mentee, right? What do we have for you now? What are the pieces? We have kept it very simple, guys. We want to start off on the Saturday of 20th of June. We know these are COVID times per month. So if you take it together, the total cost for the program is 7,000. You can pay it to us in 2 easy installments of 3,500 plus taxes, right? If we get around, and we don't want to make it a 30 people batch kind of thing, we are looking at 12 people to 13 people at most, right? And if we get a good number of that kind, probably I can promise you to also get a good psychometric assessment to enrich the experience that we have already promised to you. It could be a DISC or a Myers-Briggs that we could bring to you. If you have already done that, we could bring the shreds of that, and that will be a beautiful experience, right? So let us know, what do you think about it, right? Priya, if you want to add anything to this, anything you want to... Guys, we are open to feedback. You can tell us how it is.
First of all, I think I want to go back to. I want to go back to. If you guys have anything to add in terms of the topic, you can just ping us in the chat or let us know.
Yes.
Second, it is going to be an investment. So investment of time apart from money. So I think 3,500 is really, really, really good offer. Yeah, let us know if there's anything, and yeah, I'm just waiting to start the journey.
Hello.
Yeah, I think somebody's trying to talk. Yes, is that Radhesham? Okay. Priya, go ahead.
I'm done. I think, yeah, it got interrupted. What?
All right.
Okay. I think Priya, for the benefit of the audience, you can please repeat that again, because Radhesham voice was interrupting. We couldn't hear. So can you please repeat? Okay. That would be a
sure, great. Sure. Does Radhesham wants to speak something? Let him finish and then I can possibly.
Yeah, Radhesham, you want to speak something? Okay. All right. I take the mute to be no, right? Go ahead, Priya.
Okay. Yeah, so I was saying that we are very excited about this journey. And apart from the money, I think it's more of the, investment on our learning and investment of our energy and the group learning, sharing of experiences and everything. And if there's anything that, we can work out, if there's anything we can talk about, I think 2,500 is a good investment.
Okay.
Do you also hear this noise? Because I
think it's Mr. Jadhav. If you can kindly put yourself on mute, it's a request from all the participants.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, as a practice, I don't like muting participants per se, because that is like taking away the agency from them, right? So, but I think, feel free about it. You can talk to us. Just be mindful of the fact that we would like to get from you either side, would you be able to participate or not participate? And if you want to kind of take this off. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave you with my phone number. So, go ahead.
Yeah, okay, fine. I mean, I was just holding off till now. I'm Krishnamurthy.
Right.
Hi to everyone. I've been hearing everyone out. I deliberately kept quiet till now because it only confirms my initial suspicion. I'm an absolute outlier in this group.
Okay.
I would be, one second, let me put the video on. I'm sitting in a corner of my room.
Mm-hmm.
Right, let me just see if I can come up.
Mm-hmm. We can see you.
Okay, fine. That's great. So, hi, folks. How do I put it? I'm a retired group captain from the Indian Air Force.
Mm-hmm.
I've spent 30 years in the Air Force.
Mm-hmm.
I've come out a couple of years back. I mm-hmm. took what civilians will call a voluntary retirement.
Mm-hmm.
And what we call a premature retirement. I had the 7 years to go, but then we have been there, done it, been in all corners of the country. And then with the parents putting on age and the in-laws, etc., we thought we'll call it a day and come back to Hyderabad. I'm in Hyderabad. Mm-hmm. So many of the things that you are actually having in the menu mm-hmm. are things which resonate. Probably things which I have dealt with in some way or the other.
Mm.
The way I understand it is probably I've been practicing them. It is the practicals that we are used to rather than the theory part of it. Mm-hmm. This is one of those statements I made when I went in to do my executive MBA from Naseem Munji a few years back.
Mm.
So I was asked, why do you want to do this? I just said, management is something that we do on a daily basis. The day we got commissioned at 21 years.
Mm.
But this is the theory behind the whats and the whys. The why rather than the whats. So it's interesting. Point is, how do I leverage it or how can I add to it? How will I use it? Rather than me using it, how much can I contribute is what's interesting me here in this particular experience.
Right.
At the same time, At the same time, I have one more point issue that I mean, because it so happens that you are talking most of your people's managers, etc. For the last about 2 years, I'm with a college group. I'm director of administrative operations, etc. And also, I teach. I'm deeply interested in most of the things that you're talking about. Soft life skills. I would prefer to call them life skills rather than soft skills. But the point is that it's reaching out to people in organizations, the people managers, the people leaders in organization, I find is the biggest challenge. I really didn't know anyone. I didn't know how to go about doing it. So that was a major problem that I faced.
Mm.
So that's just my background, my thing. I've been an administrator. I've been a commanding officer. I've been an administrator. I've handled almost all the aspects of administration.
Right.
That's there. So It's just one of those things. I just wanted to say hello to everyone because I am an outlier.
You are not exactly. So allow me to make you feel absolutely part of the group, right? That you are not an outlier, Krishnamurti, because this preview session where Satya joined, where Francis joined, where a lot of us joined, Alok joined, this is a lot for taking this message to people who you know so that you can refer them to a program which you think they can invest their time on, right? And so we don't think that you are an outlier at all. Your experience, your voice of credibility, when that gets that comes as a recommendation to this program, is only going to enrich the program. In fact, someone like you, Krishnamurti, we would be happy to have you talk about crisis management in one of our industry talks. Why not have you on that, right? So we are very open to this. We come with an open mind. We feel that learning is a lot about abundance. It's not that I have an agenda and therefore this is what learning should be, right? Learning is a lot about sharing. You will learn a lot more from the group, from the peer group, then you will learn from me, Priya, or Ramneet together, or Shija.
No, I agree with what Mr. Satya had said.
Right.
Unlearning is very critical at any point in time.
Right.
He's absolutely bang on. So to unlearn and will only enable us to relearn. It's only when we empty the tank, even partially, that the fresh water can come in. The fresh water would come in. Otherwise, it would become stagnant at some point in time. That's a very good point that there's a lot of things that resonate. The point about when do we pat someone on the back and then when do we push someone?
Right.
Forge, if I may use that terminology, some of us call it the dead foot rule. The dead foot is the distance between a pat on the back and a kick in the butt. I'm sorry for putting it in a very forgy language, but the point is knowing when to pat someone, when to encourage someone, and when to push someone. So, a couple of things that directly apply here. Interesting thoughts. Yeah, anyway, we can contribute. I'm looking at a contributive kind of a thing that was going on.
Absolutely.
To add something. Yes. I think we as a team, once we start our journey, there would be a lot that you can add, Krishnamurti, because with the varied experience that you would have, we will learn more from you. And when it comes to the leveraging, you will find a lot of network here because we have a lot of people coming from L&D, HR, managers. So, yes, you will have a lot of, chances to network with people. And network is our net worth these days. So we'll figure out what exactly you want to do and then we can take it ahead. And definitely you can contribute the most with the experience and exposure that you have. So do not feel left out at all.
No, that's not a question of like. Actually, it's nice to meet people.
Yes.
The more you meet, the more you learn, the more experiences you share, the more you kind of pass it on. That's all.
Yeah.
Right, it's been interesting. It's been a very interesting 1 hour. 1 hour well spent is all I can say.
We are looking forward to have you journey.
Okay, fine.
Right. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you. Thank you for the extending the time. I look forward to meeting some of you, most of you, on 20th June.
Right. Ravi, do we have a deadline for the register? I mean, to register?
Yeah, we would ideally like you to register by next Wednesday.
18th, right?
So
is it?
18th, I think it's 17th, right?
17th, yes.
Right. Next Wednesday would be.
So any mail link, etc. for that?
Yeah, I will send across to you a link to all of this group, right? So
there's a question, that's a nice question that's come up.
Right.
Mr. Amir has a question.
Timing.
Yes. So we will share with you a mail link. We will share with you the timings. Yes. So once the group gets formed, we would typically like it to be afternoon, on a Saturday afternoon. So something like a 4 to 6, right? So you still have a little time to go after that. Or maybe a 7 to 9, right? When you're kind of done with your day's work.
And a vote or a poll.
Right, we can do a poll.
Whatever works for everyone as well.
Once we have the confirmed registrations, we will have a poll in the group. We are free for the entire Saturday. We have kept our Saturday free for you. Even our Sunday free for you, right? So that's not the challenge, right? But we will be able to work with you to see what's the best timing, right? And then to get it done for you, okay?